All right, I've got to clear this mess of a table.
Because I got a giant box. Adams RC Playground. Look at this surprise I pulled out.
All right. So the box is actually so big that I've changed up my workspace and added a second table here just for this video. This is a giant box sent from one of my favorite YouTubers, probably one of yours, Adams RC Playground. Link down in the description below. He contacted me via email. Adam recently bought a TL01 from me. So I said, Adam, I've got something for you too. Why don't you send me your address? And off we started to play this game. My box is like one third of this. I'm a little embarrassed, Adam. But I'm excited to see what's in here. So we already did pull out some tires. Is this a good view? Let me check the camera real quick. Yeah, it's not bad. I'm not really set up for these giant unboxings, but anyway, let's check it out. The two tires and wheels I saw earlier. These are the new Bronco wheels that come on the CC02. And that's a nice treat because these are newly designed wheels. And I do use these tires. Thanks, Adam. Here's the other pair. We'll go ahead and put them together. All right, now I already have an idea of what this is because of the colors already. Adam, man, why? So before I pull this out, pretty sure, I mean, I can see what it is already. You can probably see there, can't you? Oh yeah, you can. Adam had something that I was very interested in, but I wasn't ready yet for various reasons. Well, it turns out he was tired of keeping it with him because it looks like whoa. Dude. It's a Duratrax Delphi Indy car. If you don't know what this is an F1 car that came out from Duratrax in 2002, I believe. It looks like this is the kit that included a radio system. They also had another version that did not include a radio system. Both kits were pre-built. Oh my goodness, there's more in here. Oh my goodness. Dude, come on, man. What are you doing? This guy, man. Bag of stuff here. Awesome looking bag of something here. Look at this. Extra parts, tuning parts. He knows I love tuning stuff. Let's take a closer look at that in a second. Just gonna get rid of this massive box and we'll get onto the table. Adam. Thank you.
All right, we are at the table now. Let's have a quick look. We have a knuckle arm set. That's good because I like to hit walls, but I probably won't be, we'll talk about that in a bit. I'm not sure what we're going to do with this. A spring set, a tool set, a body mount, front axles, motor pod set. It's a good idea because I've gone through one of these on my F103 GT. A lot of good spare parts here. We have a very cool looking roof rack and lighting system. And that looks sweet. Wow. What an awesome surprise bag, care package box. I'm going to send him another one. This guy definitely deserves another one. We've got extra wheels, suspension piece, drivetrain and steering pieces, another toolkit in here, spare front wing, spare rear wing, some gears, diff housing. What? Adam. Oops. Yeah, so as I was saying before, Adam has sent me a Duratrax Delphi Indy car. It's a typical F1, RC F1 car, 1/10 scale, pan car style with a T-plate. Pretty sure this one came with a gear diff as well. Love the look of these tires. I remember seeing and reading about this over and over and over again in magazines, but at that time, F1 was not in my radar as we didn't have a great place to play with them. And I was young, still trying to go fast and bash. 3-shock rear suspension system. So it's got side load shocks and bump shock. Yes, it is a gear differential. Adjustable battery pack configuration. So I guess you can run it longitudinally or horizontally. That's really cool. It came with ball bearings, of course. It's not Tamiya. These treaded racing tires look really cool. I wonder if they're in the box. I don't expect them to be. I don't expect them to be in great shape if they are. But we'll find out soon.
Looks like it came with a 20-turn motor.
And a VHS tape? I never actually purchased the original Duratrax vehicles. I got a bunch of Duratrax minis, but by that time, they weren't doing VHS release, or they weren't giving out VHSs. I might have gotten DVDs, I'm not sure.
Wish I kept them all.
All right, let's open it up.
Okay, pulling the box off. Dun, 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 dun. Here's the manual.
Whoa! Well, you know how RCs are always more impressive when you see them in the flesh in front of you? They're always bigger than you thought, better looking than you thought. Wow. This radio brings back some memory because this was a very typical white labeled radio design. Oh, I thought I might have an antenna for this. Oh, look, there's an antenna in the car. I mean, the box. We have a tire and wheel combo
with some tread.
Super cool. And we have, oh, so cool. Oh, so cool.
All right. So let's take a closer look here at the table now. As mentioned earlier, it's an F1 car from 2002, made by Duratrax. As you can see, we've got carbon plates at the bottom, carbon T-plate, carbon upper deck. One of the first things I noticed right away is this chassis is very flexy and the T-plate is soft. The top deck isn't even secured properly. It's using body clips. So that allows for a lot of flex, which means there's a lot of grip, a lot of steering grip, a lot of flex, allowing the front and rear to grab traction. I'm definitely going to rebuild this and try it out at both the carpet track and outside. And I've watched a lot of videos on people driving F1 cars in loose, slippery conditions, and it's a lot more difficult. But I've been recently learning a lot about vehicle dynamics when it comes to RC F1 cars. And I figure maybe I'll use this car to demonstrate or share what I've learned. We'll go ahead and start with something that's a big deal to me, in my opinion, and that is the pod looseness. So as you can see here, there's a screw in the center. That's actually connecting this rear pod to the front portion of the chassis, and that's a pivot point. The tighter you have that, the less this will flex. Let me show you. And what that does, or so I've been told, is this side-to-sideness will help allow the front end to move over and push grip. It'll allow the front to roll, basically. That's what controls your roll. And this is just side load damping. I'm guessing you could put oil on the shafts in there to control how much it, or how fast it moves back and forth. This shock looks like it's oil filled, but I'm not sure. So on a tighter situation course, if your rear end's got too much grip and you're understeering, you want to loosen this because then that'll allow, once it turns, example, if it turns right, it'll allow the pod to push over, leaning and rolling the car onto this side. And then your kingpin springs in here are what determines how hard your tire is being pushed into the ground once you roll over. So once this pod rolls over, the spring in there determines how hard this tire is being pushed into the ground. So theoretically, more grip, more spring. Less grip, softer spring. If you're out on asphalt, and a lot of times these cars already have tons of steering, you don't need to transfer all that roll to the front. So try tightening that pod. Every F1 should have something like this somewhere. Some of them are not exactly in this location, but they're somewhere in there. If you tighten that up, you'll allow this to roll less. And if you keep a soft spring in the front, you'll have less pressure pushing the tire into the ground, equaling less grip. Continuing with the front, you see here we have two locations to put these steering links. What that essentially does is it changes your steering angle relation. That's called Ackerman. Essentially, what I know this to be is it controls your initial and mid-corner steering, how it reacts. And how it does that is if you see these links here are put on the longest settings, the longest part of the lever. So the servo essentially has to turn more in order to turn these kingpins. So initial steering here will be a little bit slower, but once it's fully turned and settled, this kingpin has been pushed to its maximum steering angle. So once a car settles into mid-corner, it'll have more steering. If you want less bite mid-corner, but quite aggressive initial cornering, you'll move it to the inside or to the shorter part of the lever. And that'll initially steer a lot quicker, but will give you a lot less of an angle. So once your car's settled in the corner, it won't turn so hard. Let's talk about toe. There are different ways we can look at this. So there's toe out, toe in, and straight. Straight is straight. Toe in will typically give you a dartier initial car, but less steering overall. If the wheels are angled in this way, once they turn, they're still going to be kind of angled towards the front. So initially it gives you steering because both tires are fighting each other, trying to turn one way. So it's already preloaded. And as soon as you hit the steering and the weight transfers over, that angle is already there, so it's going to initially react a lot quicker. But once, like I said, you've steered, there will be less angle on the inside wheel, counteracting the outside wheel that you're trying to steer in. So you have less overall steering. Toe out will give you a lot more stable car, less twitchy, less initial steering. Because both wheels are being spread outwards, there's a lot more time to transfer the weight and let the tire turn in and hook up. I hope I'm finding good ways to explain this. But mid-corner, if you have toe out, you'll get more steering because of the steeper angle that the inside wheel will be at. So this is, I can't get this to toe out right now. But if it were toed out, this would be an even more extreme angle. This would be at a less of an angle. Hopefully that makes some sense. Caster, if you can control caster, which we can't here, it looks like. But caster is the angle of the bottom of the kingpin to the top of the kingpin in relation to a straight line up and down. And the more angle you have, the more the car wants to essentially lift itself when it turns. The inside wheel will always lift the chassis in relation to the outside, therefore rolling and transferring more weight to the outside wheel. Also helps the car return to straight easier, but that's mainly in real cars. Moving back to the rear, we have a gear differential. Now what does a gear differential, or what does a differential in general do on an F1 car? Well, generally speaking, a stiffer rear diff will give you more acceleration, more push out of the corner, and more stable corner entry. How it does that is during corner entry, because there's less differential of wheel speed, it's acting sort of like an anchor or a brake, keeping it stable as the car is slowing down. Acceleration, pretty much the same thing. It's locked, it's more of a locked. The tighter it is, the more traction you'll have equally on both wheels. A looser diff will allow the car to pivot or steer on its inside wheel a lot easier, but that means less stability coming into a corner and less stability coming out of the corner. So you'll want to find your happy medium, depends on what you like. Typically, a fast car is a twitchy car. So just tune to what the driver can handle. And finally, this shock here, when the vehicle hits bumps, this is going to be reacting. The stiffer the spring, the less it'll handle bumps, but the better it'll accelerate. The softer the spring, the better it'll handle bumps, but the less traction you'll have because the spring won't be pushing down so hard on the rear wheels. The oil inside, if you've got oil inside yours, will determine the speed or the rate at which this compresses and returns. The thicker the oil, the slower it's going to react to absorbing bump, but the faster it'll react to input. The softer the oil, the better it'll handle unstable bumpy situations, but it might allow the spring to react too bouncy, causing a pogo effect. It's all about finding a medium. All right, so I'm going to make another video of probably me, possibly maybe rebuilding this and taking it to the track. This is great. It's even got the original speed control, the original motor, and the original receiver. I will probably not run it with the original receiver, but I will run it with the original electronic. This is really, really, really cool, and the timing is almost too perfect because if I can get this to run great outside on asphalt, then there is a crew that run about an hour away from me, F1 Outdoors. They're going to be trying to start, is what I heard. What era is this from? Do you know? Can you share with me? Put in the comments below. It's got really wide rear end, much wider than the front. Really big tires in the rear, much bigger than the front. This is cool. Another one I'd really love to have is the HPI, what was it called? The HPI something 10, Pier 10 or something? I don't know. HPI had an F1 car and I'd really like to check one of those out. Especially after having this. Look at this. Oh my goodness. Okay. There's not much more I can say about this. I'm just going to keep drooling. If you have some information or some stories about this, please share down in the comments below. I'm super excited to rebuild this. So if you want to see that, make sure you're subscribed so you don't miss it. Adam, you are so awesome. Thank you so much, man. I am keeping your address on file and keeping you in mind. And to everybody, as always, thanks again. Make it a great day and peace out.